Hi, Daniela.
Hi, Liz.
You help lead our coverage of European capital goods and industrials for Goldman Sachs Research. Give us a sense of how that area has been impacted by the pandemic.
The cap goods sector, being a cyclical one, was obviously very impacted by the pandemic. I would say there's two layers that we can talk about here. There's one which is very immediate financial impacts. And there is another one, which is probably where the long-term debate in the sector is being influenced by what we have seen throughout the past few months. On the first one, easier to quantify and comment. Our sector has an incredibly high correlation with macroeconomy. Things like industrial production, for example, are good leading indicators and tend to react quite immediately when we have a pronounced shock, both to demand as well as to supply, as we had this time around. And you saw that. You saw about a minus 15% organic growth decline in the top line of our companies, which almost happened instantaneously. There's obviously degrees of magnitude. You had some industries like autos and aerospace and defense, which fall more than 50%. But you also had others which had, for example, a backlog of projects already at hand, which they managed to somewhat deliver towards the second quarter. But those are the financial impacts, pretty immediate and easy to quantify. The more challenging ones is obviously the long-term impacts that might come out of these crises, which are harder to quantify.
So can you elaborate on some of those longer-term consequences?
I think in terms of where we're seeing the debate going on with the corporates at this time, on the long-term implications of the pandemic, you have had essentially two areas where the debate has accelerated. First, localization. So how can companies produce close to where demand is so that you don't have a repeat, for example, of what happened earlier this year, that when China shut down, you had spares and wares that were going elsewhere in the world into industries like automotive or trucks. That meant the whole European or US supply chain closed because of that level. And the second thing, which is also associated with that, is how can you guarantee that you produce close to demand, but at an efficient cost? And has to do with automation. How can companies automate so that they can produce with the same margins wherever their customers are? And this is really a shift from early 2000s was just about let's capture the growth opportunity in emerging markets. Then the financial crisis came and it was about let's use low-cost countries as a sourcing base. And now it's more about let's match demand and supply in an efficient way and play with automation of factories so that we can do that profitably.
So you mentioned that this is a cyclical industry and a cyclical shock. Given that, is there anything that surprised you this time around?
Yes, the biggest surprise this time around was perhaps margins. Analyst estimates were significantly lower than what companies delivered over the second quarter by almost 20%. And this happened because the margin decline that we had on this very sudden shock was much lower than you had, for example, in the prior crisis. In 2008-09, at the worst quarter, you had a 3 percentage points margin decline, but three times less volume decline than we had this time around for the same margin decline. So companies became a lot more nimble in maneuvering their cost base. Investors have discounted this positive trend as being highly influenced by furloughs and government schemes and other programs that help reduce the cost base of companies. We do think that even when we take those off numbers, that we would have had a better performance than in prior crises this time around. And why do we think that? We think that actually when if you think about the global financial crisis, for example, it followed five very strong years in terms of capital investment, which is a leading figure for the top line of capital goods and industrials. While if you look at the post-financial crisis period, out of those 10 years, 5 years actually had very weak capital expenditure developments. So companies never really got confident to put all the same cost base that they had before, and that way made it easier to adapt to the crisis in the first place.
So talk more about the dispersion that you've seen between different end markets within European industrials.
Yeah, sure. I will perhaps say and segment out two things in the positive side, two things in that stood out on the negative side. On a more negative developments, I'd say the two industries where we have seen very significant detrimental impacts were autos and aerospace and defense, where we had falls in business sales by over 50%. Interestingly, they seem to be coming out of it slightly differently. In autos, the first shock was perhaps a bit more supply-driven shock. And so we're starting already to see in July and August business metrics improving and a progressive recovery. In the aerospace industry, there was also a very big shock in demand, and it seems like the recovery is going to take a bit longer time. On the positive side, I would say two things, one more structural and the other one also with some element of cyclicality. But on the structural side, we're seeing incredibly strength and interest in capital investment into green capex. And that has not stopped. You obviously have the European Green Deal has a motivator for that. And we're seeing, for example, things like cables to connect wind offshore farms significantly benefiting from these trends and being almost unimpacted by the pandemic. And on end markets that are perhaps seeing as more cyclical, the one that stood out on the positive side was semiconductors, where the companies exposed saw a good level of resilience despite what was going on elsewhere in industrials.
So industrials is obviously a very global sector. Talk about the different responses that you've seen across the world.
Obviously, the pandemic happened in China first, but the recovery out of China was incredibly steep in March and April on the industrial base. And we've also seen China anticipating some of the projects that maybe according to their five-year plans would have come up in 2021 or after to support that growth. Interestingly, investors fear that very good March, April, May data might have just been pent-up demand, but we're seeing from June onwards the activity remaining at high levels there and continue to see good growth. You've started to see, obviously, post the depths of April and May lockdowns in Europe and in the US, also a pattern of recovery. Harder to make a distinction there between both. There was a slight lag on the declines in the US and obviously on the first data recovery in the US, but we're now actually our latest July and August industrial data and also construction expenditure data, for example, are actually pretty strong data points in the US, which is maybe a little bit contrasting, which has of the time of the second quarter, what management teams were talking about. Management teams were largely more confident in the path for recovery in Europe because of the extent of the furloughs and the safety net of support, and maybe a bit more cautious around the US. But so far, we haven't seen strong evidence of that materializing.
And what are you expecting for the CapEx cycle in the months ahead?
One good way to step back there is to tell you what we expected before we knew COVID was coming. We actually did not expect 2020 to be a positive year in terms of capital expenditure investment. We expected the slight pause and then very moderate growth in 2021, 2022. Why was that? It had to be related with the fact that we were already starting to see a slowdown of activity in the second part of 2019, and we had manufacturing capacity utilization, so the rate of how factories are running, which was broadly in line with the 30-year average. So it didn't seem like we had a huge stress to put more capital equipment in place. And that background hasn't changed necessarily. So COVID made the shock be much quicker. And if we look at our global coverage of all the industries, what is the pattern that we have in 2020 of capital expenditure? It's a high single digit fall, even more closer to 20% when you weight by the big caps. And obviously, mechanically, that level of fall means some stuff got deferred, some stuff got canceled. Some of the things that got deferred in terms of capital equipment projects this year, they might fall next year. And next year, mechanically, you get growth. But in big picture, we do not expect to see the same levels of investment we've seen in 2019 at best until mid of 2022.
Finally, Daniela, looking over the long term, where do you expect to see growth opportunities for industrials, both in Europe and beyond?
The industrial sector is very diversified, so there are many little interesting niches, but I would say two big areas that are worth talking through here. One is, I mentioned green capex. That's an area where we have seen very strong interest, and we strongly believe, particularly as it pertains to the European Green Deal and to reaching net zero emissions. It's a very important space for the sector. Somewhat around 40% of our companies get either beneficiaries or have to adjust their business models related to this. And it's not just the perhaps more talked about, let's invest in more renewables. There are other areas which are less consensual, but where we do expect to see a lot of activity in terms of investment longer term. For example, more traffic moving towards rail, which is a very energy efficient mode of transportation. And also, for example, building renovation towards energy efficient standards. So green capex, really a core theme, I think, for the sector going forward. The other topic, I've mentioned it also at the beginning, is automation and implementing the factory of the future, which is one where, as I've said earlier, you can produce where the demand is, but also given what the experience from COVID has been in terms of eventually needing social distancing, where you can have humans and also a highly dense level of automated machines collaborating together, and where you can have the whole supply chain connected digitally in real time, so that you're in full control of your system. So automation and digitization to facilitate a new type of factory is something that we continue to expect a lot of ongoing investment on.
Thanks, Daniela.
Thanks, Lisa. It was a pleasure speaking with you. Bye.
You too.